E-Health Ministry of Health, Government of India. I welcome everyone on this session, which is focused on the infection, use of PPE and biomedical rescue. This is the fifth session on the topic that we are discussing, and it has been organized by Ministry of Health with the help of AIIMS and all the regional resource center as well as which are active collaboration with IMA. These all the sessions are very much helpful regarding corona management. And last time also when we did in month of May, June, in the second week, it was very useful. And I'm sure this such dissemination of information will be useful this time also. Now I would like to request Dr. Gulen.
So good afternoon and welcome to this session for the Center of Excellence on COVID-19 management being conducted jointly by the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare and the All India Institute of Medical Sciences. In this continuing series that we have, today we're going to discuss something which I think is very important, and that is infection control, PPEs, and biomedical waste management. When we started 2 years ago, our knowledge for this of this new virus was very limited, and there was a lot of fear factor which was inherent because we were not sure how this virus spreads, how does it really cause infection, and there was this whole issue of people washing their clothes, washing vegetables before they took them inside the house, and a lot of other things being done because of the fear of droplet infection. And many areas were repeatedly cleaned. Surfaces were repeatedly cleaned because there was this fear that this infection may spread by fomites and other things. We've come a long way since then. We realized more about the virus. We had this whole debate about droplet and aerosol infection, which is more important depending on the particle size, more than 5 microns, less than 5 microns. And in a given state, what is the degree of infection? What is the chance of infection in an indoor environment where ventilation is not good as compared to an outdoor environment? What should we do in terms of PPEs that we were initially wearing? What should we now wear? As our knowledge has become more, should we wear those space suit type of PPEs, the overalls or the coveralls that we were wearing initially, or do we really need to be so much worried? Because it's mainly if you have protected your nose and mouth, then you are reasonably well protected and you don't really need to worry too much. So I think there are a lot of issues as far as this is concerned. And to discuss all of this, we have Dr. Gagandeep Singh, who's a Distinguished Professor of Microbiology. He's very actively involved in our hospital infection control team, and therefore is the right person to really give us an idea as far as this is concerned. We also have our panelists, like we have every time, Dr. Anjan Trika, Professor Anesthesia, Dr. Aarti Kapil, who has come before also as Professor of Microbiology, Dr. Anand Mohan from Pulmonary Critical Care and Sleep Medicine, Dr. Manish Suneja from the Department of Medicine, Dr. Kapil Soni, Neeraj Nishchal, and of course, the clinicians from the state centers of excellence and office bearers and members of the IMA. So welcome to you all. And I would really now request Gagandeep to give his presentation on the topic, and then we can have a panel discussion and question answer session. So over to you, Dr. Gagandeep Singh.
Thank you, sir. Yes. So I'll be discussing about infection control, PPE use, and biomedical waste management in context of COVID-19. And this is just the outline of how I'll be giving my presentation. I'll be discussing in two slides the basics about infection transmission, and then further on regarding the prevention of this infection, where I'll be discussing standard precautions, which includes hand hygiene, cough etiquettes, and the appropriate or rational use of the PPE, transmission-based precautions, cleaning and disinfection, a little bit about ventilation, because that has really come up as an important factor for prevention of infection. And finally, I'll be discussing the biomedical waste management. So I think all of us know about the chain of transmission of infection, which includes positive agents, the reservoir, the portal of exit from the reservoir, mode of transmission, portal of entry into the host, and susceptible host. And removing any one link breaks the chain and prevents infection. And that is what we focus for infection prevention and control. As Sir just mentioned, I think in the past 2 years, a lot has been added to our knowledge. And we know that majorly this infection is droplet borne, which so the droplets are more than 5 micron in size, and rather actually they may even run into hundreds of microns in size. However, they may be in closed environments. Some aerosols may be generated or droplet nuclei may be there, which may remain suspended for a very brief period of time. So it's very important for infection prevention related to droplet infections, in addition to respiratory precautions, because the droplets, they settle down on immediate surfaces around the infected patient. So disinfection of inanimate surfaces in close proximity to that patient and high touch surfaces are very necessary. So prevention can be classified as standard precautions and transmission based precautions. So what are standard precautions? These are a set of infection control practices that healthcare personnel use to reduce transmission of microorganisms in healthcare setting. And this is, you know, standard precautions usually it doesn't consider whether a patient is infectious or non-infectious or which type of infection it is. So whenever you're dealing with a patient, standard precautions are applicable to each and every patient. And standard precautions protect both healthcare personnel as well as patients from contact with infectious agents. So it protects both the patient as well as the healthcare professional. So if I talk about components of standard precautions, the WHO defines 7 components. And as far as COVID-19 is concerned, the first 5 are applicable, which include hand hygiene, cough etiquettes, personal protective equipment, cleaning and disinfection, and biomedical waste management. And I'll be covering all of these in brief in the next few slides. So coming to hand hygiene procedures include use of alcohol-based hand rubs, and usually the range is around 60 to 95% of alcohol, and hand washing with soap and water. And alcohol-based hand rubs, they are preferred method of decontaminating hands, except when hands are visibly soiled as far as COVID-19 is concerned, in which case we need to use soap and water. And hand hygiene stations should be strategically placed to ensure easy access. And we've seen that if we keep alcohol-based hand rubs on each bed or on in each cubicle, the compliance rate amongst healthcare workers is definitely much, much higher. So these are the 6 steps of hand hygiene. And I won't go into the details because I'm sure all of us know these steps. The key point to be noted as far as, you know, when we are using hand rubs is that an appropriate amount, almost 5 to 6 ml of alcohol should be taken. Initially, all the surfaces of the hands should be covered. And then only once the surfaces are covered with alcohol, we should start doing the steps. And the steps are such that each and every surface is covered between the fingers, the nails, the knuckles, the base of thumb, which are key areas while performing hand hygiene. If we talk about soap and water, the key component or the key time taken for performing hand hygiene between alcohol-based hand rub and soap and water is almost the same. However, the additional 20 to 30 seconds that is taken while performing hand hygiene with soap and water is during wetting our hands and performing and forming lather. However, the basic steps are the same. Then when these are the 5 moments of hand hygiene that have been put forth by WHO, and these are opportunities of when all should be performed hand hygiene. So it's before coming in contact with the patient and before any clean or aseptic procedure. Then after coming in contact with any of the body fluids and respiratory fluids as far as the COVID-19 is concerned, after touching the patient and after touching the patient's environment. So these are the 5 moments or 5 opportunities. It might not be necessary that every time you come in contact with the patient, all have to be done. So whenever an opportunity comes, hand hygiene should be performed. Cough etiquettes, again, extremely important as far as COVID is concerned. We should cover our mouth and nose with a tissue or a handkerchief whenever we are sneezing or coughing. If that is not available, we should cover the face with our elbow. Healthcare workers should ideally be wearing a face mask to protect themselves. And finally, even as part of the cough etiquettes, hand hygiene is extremely important because hands become regularly contaminated. So here again, you can either use alcohol-based hand rub or soap and water. Another important aspect of the standard precautions are the PPE used in healthcare setting. we know by now that a very important component of the PPE as far as COVID-19 is concerned are the masks and the respirators. They protect our mouth and nose. Respirators, they protect the respiratory tract from airborne infectious agents, which are very small in size. And I'll be coming to these in more detail in the subsequent slides. Gloves, they protect our hands. Gowns, it protects our skin or the underlying clothing. Goggles, they protect our eyes. And face shields, they protect the face, mouth, nose, and eyes and gives a wider protection. Talking about the filtering face piece respirators, which are more commonly known as N95. However, N95 is interchangeably used with the FFRs. However, there are other standards used internationally, like the FFP2 in Europe, the KN95 in China, and the P2 in Australia and New Zealand. All of these almost have equivalent filtering efficiency of around 94 to 95% in filtering out particles more than 0.3 micron in size. So one very important aspect which we need to remember as healthcare workers is to properly put on and take off these respirators. While putting on the respirator, you have to place the respirator with the hand on your nose and mouth, and then you should put the straps on. It doesn't really necessarily, whether you put the top strap or the bottom strap first, it's not very important. While taking off, that sequence becomes really more important. And once you've placed the FFR, you have to, because the nose is the main part which, there's denting, and it's important that the filtering face piece respirator, it properly fits. So you need to press the metal strip which is on the nose so that it takes the shape of your nose bridge. Once you've worn the N95 or the FFR, it's very important to check the seal. So this can be done by placing both the hands over the respirator, and you quickly take a breath in and check whether there are any leaks around, and then following that you can exhale and see if there are any further leaks around the FFR. And if there are any leaks, you have to adjust the straps or the fitting of the FFR around the nose. And once this is achieved, you're ready to go into the area. While removing the respirator, we need to keep one thing which is very important to keep bear in mind is that we should not touch the front of the respirator because it might be contaminated with the infectious agent. And here the sequence of removing the straps is important because we need to remove the lower strap first, followed by the upper strap, because if you remove the upper strap first, it might just fall off and come off, and the healthcare worker may be at risk of exposure. And once you have to hold the mask with the straps, and then you have to discard it in an appropriate way. Coming to PPE usage in hospitals, many PPE that we use, it has to be according to the hospital infection prevention control practices locally in your hospital. And the PPE should be used based on the risk of exposure and the extent of contact anticipated. Currently, be it a COVID ICU or a ward, emergency screening area, or COVID testing laboratory, a full component of PPE is what is recommended. And that includes N95 mask, gown, goggles, with or without face shields, gloves, and shoe covers and head covers may also be worn. In non-COVID areas, especially in a hospital setting, an N95 mask may suffice. If the risk is not very high, even a triple layer mask can be worn. Again, sequence. Once you know what PPE has to be worn in the particular area that you're going into, sequence of donning is important. Gowns are usually worn first, followed by the mask or the respirator. Goggles or face shield, and finally gloves. Again, gloves can be simple gloves or the non-sterile gloves. And if you're going to perform any sterile procedure, sterile gloves can also be worn. Currently, the concept of wearing double gloves has been done away with, it as it has shown not to be giving any additional protection. Sequence of doffing is also extremely important because this is the time. Doffing is the time where the healthcare worker actually is exposed to the infectious agent. So this has to be done with utmost care, and preferably there should be a buddy who should guide you through these steps And because gloves are the most contaminated, gloves are removed first, followed by face shield or the goggles. Thirdly is the gown, and then finally mask or the respirator is removed just, you know, while leaving that area, or even it can be removed after coming out of that area. And finally, alcohol-based hand rub or hand hygiene has to be performed. The sequence that I've shown here is one of the sequences that is available with the CDC, and the multiple sequences as to how a PPE can be doffed are available. After considering hand hygiene and PPE, I'll be coming to transmission-based precautions, because we know COVID-19 is basically a droplet-based infection. So droplet precautions and contact precautions are to be applied in any case or any healthcare worker who comes in contact with a suspect or a confirmed COVID-19 case. And in this situation, an appropriate PPE is to be worn. Patients particularly require isolation in rooms, or they can be cohorted into a large facility where all COVID positive patients are kept. And there should be limited movement of the patients outside rooms. And patients should be encouraged to wear surgical masks for source control, and they should observe cough etiquettes. However, when we are performing any aerosol generating procedure, airborne precautions in addition to droplet and contact precautions should be applied. I mean, when we are doing an aerosol generating procedure, airborne precautions and contact precautions are to be followed. Coming to cleaning and disinfection. So, because we're dealing with a very labile virus, we are lucky that, you know, it gets inactivated by a large number of disinfectants. And we have a whole list of disinfectants available, like alcohols, sodium hypochlorite, hydrogen peroxide, phenols, quaternary ammonium compounds. And the reason why we've narrowed down to these three was, one is easy availability, they are cheap. And of course, the contact time is very low. So 1% sodium hypochlorite is one of the most commonly used disinfectants. One thing to be borne in mind is that it should be always freshly prepared. And once prepared, it should be used as early as possible, usually within 4 to 6 hours. 70% alcohol, the range is around 60 to 90%. It can be as low as 60% for ethanol and higher for isopropanol. And this can be used for metal surfaces, delicate equipment, thermometers, stethoscopes, BP cuffs, etc. And in addition to these two, even hydrogen peroxide, any percentage more than 0.5 can be used for delicate equipment. And for delicate equipment, actually, the manufacturer's instructions should be followed for disinfection of whatever kind of equipment you're dealing with. Before starting disinfection, the sanitation worker should wear appropriate PPE, which includes normally N95 mask, gloves. The gloves have to be heavy duty, and water resistant gown, long boots. So this is what they should wear. Apply the disinfectants to surfaces using damp cloth or spray and mop technique. So it has to be either a wet cloth or a spray and mop technique. Only spray should not be used, because if you spray, it may unevenly cover the area, and there might be areas left where the droplets are there and it does not come in contact with the disinfectant. So just spray does not suffice. And also it might generate certain aerosols. Whenever we clean, there should be a steady sweeping motion. There should be no splashes, again, to prevent any aerosol generation. And as with any disinfectant, once the disinfectant is applied to any surface, it has to be given appropriate contact time. So like in case of sodium hypochlorite or hydrogen peroxide, a minimum contact time of 10 minutes should be given. Sodium hypochlorite, 10 minutes. Hydrogen peroxide, it depends upon the percentage. If it's 3%, it's 10 minutes. If it is lower percentage, you have to increase the time period for contact. So cleaning has to be thoroughly done of the ICUs, wards. All high touch surfaces need to be cleaned. So here you can see, this is the spray and mop technique. First, the surface has been sprayed upon and then mopped properly. Each and every surface has been cleaned. Checklists are again very important. We've seen that for monitoring whether the disinfection in areas has been done or not. So checklists really are helpful, because you are defining areas which need to be cleaned, how frequently those need to be cleaned. So, and plus there is the responsibility of one person, like mostly in our hospital, we were assigning this to the sister in charge of that areas to monitor whether the disinfection is being done or not. So checklists have a role. Just briefly about cleaning at homes, cleaning of frequently touched surfaces in the room, be it tabletops, doorknobs and handles, etc., can be done in patients who are in isolation or people who are under quarantine with 1% sodium hypochlorite solution. Or even if 1% sodium hypochlorite is not available, a simple soap or detergent and water can be used. Toilet surfaces, again, daily cleaning with regular household bleach solution can be done. Even phenolics can be used for disinfection of toilets. Clothes and linen, again, they should be washed separately using common household detergent and then should be dried appropriately. Just a few words about ventilation before I move on to biomedical waste management. So this is the hierarchy of controls which was put forward by the National Institute for Occupational Safety and Health under the CDC USA. And you can very well see that whenever we want to control, especially prevention of infection of this kind, PPEs are one of the least effective. They are, because PPEs are targeted to individuals. Engineering controls have a wider impact. So if you have engineering modification in an area in the form of modifications in ventilation or design, they have a much larger impact as far as infection control is concerned. So ventilation, as far as COVID-19 is concerned, in addition to the heating ventilation and air conditioning, most of the places have 12 air changes per hour. So if you want to improve the ventilation over and above the ventilation that you already have, it's important, or multiple steps can be taken, like increasing the introduction of outdoor or fresh air, which can be done by opening outdoor air dampers beyond the minimum setting in your HVAC systems. If that cannot be done, you can open windows and doors, weather permitting. Like nowadays, at least in Delhi, it's very cold. It's difficult for us to open windows throughout the day. However, briefly, maybe a few minutes every hour can be, the windows or doors can be opened just to have a circulation of the air in that particular area. Use fans to increase the effectiveness of opening the windows. So place window fans to exhaust room air to the outdoors and ensure restroom exhaust fans are functional and operational at full capacity, because these do create a flow of air in that facility. So these should always be kept on. And in addition to these two, there's been increasing evidence that portable high efficiency particulate air or the HEPA filtration systems contribute in effectively cleaning the air, and they may also be used. And also the ultraviolet germicidal irradiation, which is the UVGI, can be used as a supplemental treatment. And there are different types, like the upper room UVGI or induct UVGI. Wherever it is possible, it may be used. I know it's very difficult. Most of the old hospitals have HVACs which are already in place. Retrofitting is not easy technically, and it may also be expensive, but whatever is possible to increase the ventilation should be done. That is the bottom line. Coming to biomedical waste management, we know this is just the general table. General waste goes into black. Human anatomical and chemotherapeutic drugs, they all go in yellow. Contaminated plastic waste, because it is recyclable, it goes into red. All sharps and metals go into the plastic container, and the broken, discarded and contaminated glass goes into the wooden box. So what modification has been done as far as biomedical waste is concerned? So while discarding the PPEs, we know that used goggles, face shields, splash proof aprons, plastic coveralls, hazmat suits, nitrile gloves, these all, because they contain a large content of plastic, so they should be discarded into the red bag. Used masks, including the triple layer mask, the N95 mask, head cover, cap, shoe cover, disposable linen gowns, non-plastic or the semi-plastic coveralls, whatever is thin, it usually goes into the yellow bag. If you are at home, So waste masks and gloves in general households can be kept in paper bags for a minimum of 72 hours and disposed as dry general waste after cutting the same. And what 72 hours does when you're storing them in paper bags is that it dries out all the the droplets of the droplet nuclei, and the virus basically becomes non-viable. So that is the reason why we can hold these, after cutting them up, we can hold these for almost 3 days in a paper bag. For COVID-19 areas in the hospital, as all of you know, double layered bags using two bags of the same color should be used. They should be of adequate strength and should prevent leakage of the biomedical waste. There should be a dedicated collection bin labeled as COVID-19 it should be stored in a separate temporary storage room. Bags, bins, trolleys, whichever is utilized, should be labeled as COVID-19 waste for transportation of this waste. And there has to be a nodal officer responsible for all the operations in every healthcare facility. And this is generally done, and everybody knows that whatever waste is being generated has to be daily updated onto the COVID-19 BMW app. As far as the quarantine camps and the home care is concerned, again, biomedical waste, especially the mask, gloves, tissue, swabs, syringes, and medicines, if at all they are being produced in little large numbers, so they can be put into a yellow bag and handed over to a designated deposition center or the urban local bodies in that area. And they'll then take care of it. Again, there has to be a nodal officer of that area who updates onto the app. And there has to be daily collection by the urban local bodies of this biomedical waste that is generated. So, thank you so much. These are evolving guidelines, and they keep changing according to guidelines from the ministry, the ICMR, WHO, CDC.
Thank you, Dr. Gagandeep. Before we go on to the question answer session, I'll ask Dr. Aarti Kapil if she would like to say something.
Right. Thank you, sir. And thank you, Dr. Gagan. I think you have mentioned in great detail. And I'm sure now it's become very clear that the most important component of PPE in prevention of COVID-19 infection is the mask. The N95 mask, to be more sure, it takes care of the droplet as well as the other airborne routes. Plus, if you are doing some aerosol generating procedure, an added face shield. So we must focus on that. I must again reiterate that sometimes we tend to feel more confident with the total coverall kind of a PPE, but please remember, putting that on and then not taking care of your mask will not protect you. Therefore, let us focus our attention on protecting our nose and mouth. So I think I'll just reiterate that. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much for that sort of clarification and focusing on that, because that is, I think, something that we've learned over the last 2 years. I don't know if there are a lot of questions. Dr. Ambuj is there. Otherwise, I can ask a few things for clarification, but it's more generic. So, Ambuj, you want to ask the questions, or should I ask a few questions from my own side? You're muted, Ambuj.
Yeah, can you hear me, sir?
Yes, yes.
Yeah. So I don't see too many questions so far. So
I'll start a few questions, and maybe that will get people motivated.
Right.
So I'm going to ask both probably Dr. Gagandeep and maybe some comments from Neeraj also. When we talk of masks, especially for the general public, then we have this issue of cloth mask, surgical mask, and N95. So with the current variant of Omicron, what would you advise people to wear? Because this is a common question which is asked to healthcare workers. Can I wear a cloth mask? Should I now have you switch over to a surgical three-layered mask? Or should I now wear an N95? Things have also changed. There was a time when N95 were not freely available. Now that situation is probably not there, but still everyone can't have an N95. So your advice, Dr. Gagandeep, and then I'll ask Neeraj, and if then Dr. Aarthi has anything to add.
So, sir, actually it depends upon the availability, I think is one major factor. If at all available, a surgical mask definitely has that filtering layer, which efficacy-wise is better than cloth mask. So if available, a surgical mask, and if not, then definitely a well-fitting. I think one very important factor for any mask is it has to be well-fitting.
Correct. I think that is very important. Dr. Neeraj, anything you would like to add?
Yes, sir. So for general public, at least I will say the way they wear masks, that is the most important aspect, because most of the time they may be carrying an N95 mask, but the way they are wearing is not appropriate. So just by carrying a very good quality mask is not going to save them. They have to use it properly. Even when if you are using a cloth mask, you have to ensure that there is a nose clip so that it fits properly around your nose and mouth area. That is again very important. And the type of cloth mask, one can easily check whether if light is crossing through that mask, then that means that mask may not be actually protecting them properly. So if it's a cloth mask where light is not passing that freely and you have a nose clip with that, that can be used for general public as such. But wherever possible, if the risk is higher, then of course the quality of mask has to go on a better quality. And of course, in medical facilities and where you have to take care of COVID patients, even in houses, wherever possible, wear N95, but wear it properly. That's very important.
Thank you. So I think the most important message here is that whatever be your mask, surgical, cloth mask or N95, wearing the mask is very, very important. When we're saying wearing the mask, make sure that it tightly sort of forms a snug around your nose, your cheeks, and the chin. Air should not come in from the side of the mask. It should come in through the mask, and therefore the mask will be effective only then. So that type of checking is very important. People tend to, even if you wear an N95 mask, but it's loosely around your face, or you haven't covered your nose, then there is no use wearing a mask. So I think it's very important to wear it properly rather than worry too much. Yes, in a graded manner, N95, if worn properly, will give you the best protection. If that is not available, a properly worn surgical mask, but even a cloth mask will provide some protection as long as you wear it properly. Anjan wanted to say something.
As we are all aware, there is some amount of finances involved as far as general public is concerned. We can talk about N95 surgical mask, 3-layered, 5-layered. But as an expert group, we have to address an issue which is there for the general public also, which our fellow colleagues who are listening to our panel discussion can disseminate. First, can the cloth mask, which as Neeraj has pointed out, is thick enough, can it be washed and worn again? And can an N95 mask be washed and worn again? Because you see a lot of people in general public who are wearing a dirty or a soiled surgical mask for 2 days, 3 days, and then I'm sure it is spreading more infection or not. So maybe Dr. Gagandeep can answer whether...
Yes, so there were some guidelines in terms of N95 masks being reused every fourth day by keeping it there. So maybe Dr. Gagandeep, you can highlight on how one can do that in terms of sort of being able to decrease the cost and being able to use that. This is more for the general public, not in a COVID area.
Yes, sir. So, if we are talking about reuse of an N95, first I'd like to address to the question that Dr. Anjan had asked, that whether we can use reuse after washing. So, that is completely a no-no, because the principle behind an N95 is it uses electrostatic charges. So, once we have washed it with the detergent, you know, the electrostatic charges between the filtering layers, then those are lost. So, you never wash and reuse an N95. Regarding reusing by, keeping them in paper bags, so we've also been doing it, and it is recommended by the CDC as well, that if you have enough number of N95 masks, 4 or 5 masks, so what you can do is after using it, you can, first is you label them. So if you have 5 masks, you label them as 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And then whenever you use one mask, you appropriately place them into paper bags, not plastic bags. These have to be in paper bags, because again, what we want to achieve is total drying of whatever droplets they've landed on the mask. So again, you keep them for a period of 4 to 5 days, and then you can use them after that, because more than 72 hours usually, if they have passed, so the virus becomes non-viable and you can reuse the mask.
Okay.
Just one point I would like to highlight while we are focusing on the use of masks for protecting ourselves. If a patient is wearing a cloth mask also, that will be useful in the source control. So please remember, even that is very important. If every patient is wearing a mask, or any person who has infection or suspected, then source control is definitely there with whatever sort of mask, because it will stop the droplets coming out of the patient.
Okay. I think we have, before I ask a few more questions, two things. One is, of course, I think we have a few questions on the chat box, which Ambuj can ask. And secondly, if any of the doctors from the center of state, from the state center of excellence, or from IMA have any comments or questions, they could also raise their hands and ask them. Otherwise, over to you, Ambuj.
So there's one question, and this has been a problem even in the West. Sometimes the N95 masks are not available, and there's a doctor who asks that we do not currently have a supply of N95 masks. So in such situations, what could they do?
Okay, so if I assume you're working in the hospital, both COVID and a non-COVID area, and for reasons, the hospital is not able to supply you N95. So what are the solutions then? So Dr. Gagandeep, your comments, and then if Anjan or Kapil have anything else to add.
So if at all, generally a surgical, a well-fitting surgical mask should do, only in cases of, if you're performing an aerosol generating procedure, one would not recommend that you go ahead and perform the procedure with just a surgical mask. So if that is the situation, at least a well-fitting surgical mask, in addition, a face shield can be used, if at all.
Yes. So I think the most important thing here is to use the face shield. Now, before I ask Anjan, I'm going to add on to this. Some people argue that will it be better then in a COVID area to wear two masks? If they wear a double layered mask, will that provide them added protection, and will that be better than a single surgical mask? So Gagandeep and then Dr. Anjan.
Again, the issue is of wearing it correctly. So even the CDC recommends that you can wear two masks, but it is not that both need to be surgical. One can be a surgical mask, and then to make that surgical mask fit properly, you can maybe wear a cloth mask on top of that, which will make it fit appropriately. So I don't think so there's any role of wearing two surgical masks together.
Okay.
See, what we have seen is when this question was from a government hospital, and he said that they don't have the mask. What is important is the gentleman has to insist that at least the surgical mask which comes is a standard surgical mask. There are so many mask boxes available in the market, which are single layered or maybe twin layered. So they have to insist, at least in a government hospital, you have a triple layered mask. Then you will have a triple layered surgical mask without the nose clip, because even the nose clip costs money and people tend to cut corners on that. So they have to insist there is a nose clip. The third thing is the kind of tag which is there to tie the mask. Sometimes it's a kind of a rubber band kind of a thing. There is a cloth tag which you've got to, a paper kind of a string which is to be tied. So that becomes very important. So covering of the face, and then if a mask is not available which is good quality, then this gentleman can wear a cloth mask over it, as Dr. Gagandeep has said, so that it is tight fitting. At our place, we insist that if a person is going inside an operation theater, he surely wears a triple layered surgical mask. And in the operation theater, if intubation has to be done or a procedure has to be done, a kind of a shield is also worn. Our own residents and faculty members now find shields more comfortable, because the goggles which they used were getting fogged, and they tried all possible things to make it have defogging kind of chemicals, but nothing really worked much. It worked for some, but it didn't work for much.
Okay.
Kapil,
you want? Yeah. Okay, you can go on. Back to you, Ambuj.
Yeah, yes, sir. So the next question is how to use the currency notes and coins, somebody is asking. And then how do you sterilize them? I think there's little role for formaldehyde now, but...
So this question was there in the past also, and people were not willing to take currency notes from the shopkeepers because they were worried that the surfaces could get contaminated, and this was true for coins. So Dr. Gagandeep, any comments from your side, and then maybe Dr. Aarti Kapil can add.
I think it's much better to perform hand hygiene after you handle currency notes. So that is one important thing that can be done.
Okay. So I think that's the most important thing. It's not only currency notes, whatever. If you're outside and you're touching surfaces, it could be traveling in the metro or traveling in a bus or other areas. It's important that you follow proper hand hygiene practice.
Right. I wanted to hear an opinion from Dr. Gagandeep and Dr. Aarti Kapil. There were so many devices available now that you are talking about notes, which were boxes which had UV light coming, and a lot of pharmaceuticals were, instead of giving you pens and pencils as a as kind of a to write their brand of drugs, they were giving those. Are they really effective? I've seen a lot of people putting the notes, the shopkeepers in that, and switching it on and then giving it to you. Or it is just one of those gimmicks which never works.
Okay, you had boxes also for a lot of things which were given, which were actually marketed by various companies. So what is your take on that, Dr. Gagandeep?
Sir, as far as the UV boxes are concerned, one thing which we need to remember about UV is that it has almost no penetration. Only there will be surface disinfection, number one. Plus, there has to be some minimum exposure time where the article needs to be exposed to. You have seen people just putting articles in a UV box for 5 minutes and then considering it done. So many factors. And in addition, UV lamps, usually they have a life, a limited life. So again, if you're using the same box over months, so again, it will be ineffective. So again, I would suggest anybody using a UV box, it's better to perform hand hygiene appropriately than use UV boxes.
Yeah, penetration is important, that it doesn't really penetrate. So sometimes people were using that for files with the assumption that the whole file would get sort of sterilized, if we put it that way, but that is not effective. Okay, over to you, Ambuj.
Yeah, so one question, it's an interesting question. The panelist says that we all have had COVID. So he implies he's had COVID. Does he still need to be wearing the mask because he feels suffocated and breathless? So what about people who have had COVID in the current wave?
So you still need to wear a mask because for two reasons. One is this doesn't mean that you cannot get infection again. We do see the infection. You may be protected for some time. And you may be infectious and giving the virus to others. So wearing a mask is important from your side and from others' point of view. But I'll add on to this, and this is something I'm going to ask Neeraj and Dr. Anjan. A lot of people say that if I wear a mask for long, my saturation will fall. Others have argued that, there is CO2 retention because there is rebreathing happening and I may go into CO2 narcosis. So your comments on that, Neeraj, and then Anjan.
Sir, in fact, in one of the questions, somebody has asked whether we are going to have cerebral hypoxia because of this thing, if we wear masks for prolonger. So there is sufficient data. In fact, even in the past, surgeons have been using masks for hours on for performing complicated surgeries, and there have never been any report of them suffering any sort of damage because of that. And of course, during COVID-19, world over, people have been wearing masks and doing their duties for prolonged hour. And of course, even at AIIMS, we have been doing these prolonged hour duties. And being part of that team, I personally, if that would have happened, of course, I would have also developed cerebral hypoxia by now, which is not the case. So from the available evidence and from personal experience, I can say there is no known side effects of wearing these tight-fitting masks. And of course, it has to be an approved mask. That's important. If you are wearing a mask, which is a fancy mask, which is not porous, which is not allowing any sort of exchange of gases, then that's a different thing. But all available medical masks, if you use it properly, then there's no chance of you getting any sort of side effect in form of hypoxia or CO2 narcosis or CO2 retention related problems.
You know, the term cerebral hypoxia and CO2 narcosis are the end, you know, at the end of the spectrum. And I don't think that these are good enough terms in this regard. These things came up into social media and into the newspapers because a lot of people going for morning walks or going for morning jogs felt claustrophobic or they were not able to run. So they used to point out that they will be doing the same, or if they go to the gym, they will be doing without a mask. If you are doing your normal jobs, as Neeraj has said, 8-hour surgery, 10-hour surgery, we don't really need to change the mask. But what becomes important is that if for any reason the mask becomes soiled, suppose somebody has had a couple of, he sneezes a couple of times, then it's worthwhile to change that mask and wear a new surgical mask. I can assure everybody that nobody would land up into cerebral hypoxia or land up into carbon dioxide narcosis, even if he or she wears a mask for 4 to 5 hours at a stretch and does her normal work or surgery or works in a theater.
Body get used to it. So.
Okay, back to you, Ambuj.
Yeah. So there's one question. This is on the YouTube, and it's something which is comes up very commonly in hospital setups. Is that, you know, suppose a patient of COVID-19, a procedure is done in an OT or in a cath lab, or a cubicle occupied by a patient, and he turns positive. So how long do you need to remain? I think you covered this, but Gagandeep, could you just maybe again reanswer? How do we kind of sanitize that area? How long it remains to be vacant, the OT, the lab, before we reuse?
Okay, over to you, Gagandeep.
So it really depends upon, you know, as soon as possible, it can be reused after disinfection, because there are people who, you know, they do fogging of that cubicle or fogging of that OT, which is really not required. Again, I need to reiterate that it's a droplet-borne infection. And if there's appropriate ventilation in that OT, even if there are certain aerosols, they've been already washed off. So if all the surfaces are being cleaned as soon as, you know, that contact time has been given of that disinfectant that is being used, you can use that area again. So we don't need to perform fogging in that area and then wait for 2 hours and then reuse that facility.
Okay, Dr. Arthi, any comments? Okay, we can go on to the next question.
Yeah. So the other question again asked, I think Dr. Anjan touched on it briefly, but is a practical problem for people wearing specs typically. So anybody can share their experience how to reduce fogging with
fogging while wearing a mask.
I distinctly remember that during the first phase we have these early morning meetings. It must have taken about 4 to 5 hours during the first wave trying to solve this problem, but it never got solved. Most of our faculty members and residents had their own way to do it. Amazon had a special page on anti-fogging sprays, which each one of them bought or the hospital bought. Some even said that you could spit on your goggles and then wear them. These are all these things have happened and they are on the net. However, a tightly fitting mask is what is needed. And if you feel uncomfortable, see, if you're wearing your own glasses and then you wear a glass over it, then it will become uncomfortable. So a good... if you don't wear glasses, a good shield does a job, and we were unable to find a permanent solution to fogging. Everybody has had its own way. Somebody used to put something on the face. So over the last 6-9 months, everybody has found a way to decrease the incidence of fogging, but nobody can swear by it that this is the way out.
Yeah, some people tend to put a small tape on top of the upper part of the mask to prevent air from leaking and going up towards the glasses. But like Anjan mentioned, people have found their own ways of doing that.
Right. There's this another question. Again, it's on YouTube about use of ultraviolet to disinfect the N95. I don't know whether that's possible. Any answers.
I think what is being probably theoretically being said that if you use your N95 instead of keeping it for 72 hours, if you put it in the ultraviolet box for some time, is that good to reuse it again on the next day? Innovative idea, your comments on that, Dr. Gagandeep and maybe Dr. Aarti then.
So, sir, there are protocols available, especially there's a big protocol from University of Nebraska where they show that UV can be used. However, because this was a major concern when we thought there'll be shortage of N95 masks, that is where we had looked into, even we had made protocols thinking that probably we'll have to reuse. But because there wasn't any shortage, so these have really not been used very often. But there are definitely protocols for that.
Okay, there are protocols, but again, it's not really something that has been looked at in a very scientific manner. And I think we need more data as far as it's concerned. But there were protocols because there was a time when there was this acute shortage of N95s, especially for healthcare workers. Okay, over to you, Ambuj.
Yes. The next question is, I think we reuse face shields, but people are asking, can we reuse a face shield?
Yes, so how can we reuse a face shield and what can be done? So, Gangadeep and Dr. Aarti, any comments? And maybe Anjan can say what we are doing then. Yeah.
So, we, the Hospital Infection Control Committee, it's recommended that 0.5% sodium hypochlorite is good enough for disinfection of face shield. One thing that has to be borne in mind that the entire face shield has to be immersed in sodium hypochlorite. So then only it will be effective, and then it has to be rinsed with the water and then used again.
Okay.
Regarding face shield, again, there was a galaxy of kind of face shields available. One was what you get while traveling by air. It's a simple kind of a thickened polythene which has a strap around the head, and it is a disposable one. So those disposable ones have to be disposed as per standard protocols. Then you had those bubble ones, like you had helmets and you have bicycle helmets and visors in front of them. They could be taken care of, as Dr. Gagandeep has said. But the problem seen with us and the complaint was that if you do wash them regularly or clean them and then wash them and dry them, then they tend to get a lot of scratches over them, like normally it would happen with your glasses, and the vision is not good. So I suggest that you take care of it, as Dr. Gagandeep has said. But after, let's say, 5 to 10 usages, if there are scratches in front of the shield, they will have to be discarded. Otherwise, they will become not popular.
Okay.
Right, sir. There's one question on, handling post-mortality. There's been a lot of changes in that also. You covered it, but probably I missed that part, but just for re-emphasis for everybody, how do you handle in case of a mortality? What are the procedures for handling the body, and what are the things you would like to tell the family in, when they handle the body?
Okay, Gagandeep, any comments from your side? Freeze again.
Maybe Dr. Ma'am can take it and see that.
There has actually been no change in this Omicron variant COVID-19 pandemic at the present time. But I think it still holds true as per the ICMR and ministry guidelines, is to have a double layered packing and to disinfect the surroundings and the surfaces. But I think the fear that was there earlier of not even handling it to the relatives, not even showing the face to the relatives, that has gone. So, but packaging is still a double layered packaging, with making sure that the surfaces and the areas around should be disinfected properly. Otherwise, there has been no change. So maybe actual practice.
See, I think what the person wants to know is that what do you do with somebody has really outcome is bad? And there was a huge scare earlier on. People were not really seeing the faces of the bodies when we were giving them. Over the 2 years, things have changed. But equally important is whatever Dr. Rati Kapil has said, it is perfect, that the relatives who come and who plan to take the body home or who want to see the face of the body, the person who's died, they should be wearing the mask properly. It is really not advisable that you tend to hug the body after the thing has been, the body has been packed and then it has to be taken home. And it has to be taken home, if at all it has to be taken home. There are various agencies available who will make coffins like you get. But precautions of wearing a mask by the relatives is always on. The bodies are packed the way CDC or ICMR guidelines tell us. After that, the problem starts. There are certain rituals in various religions which are followed by after death, which we have to give respect to, as let's be honest. But wearing of mask and sanitizing and all that stuff and ventilation in the room, if a body is taken home and then kind of like we all know, you know, clothes are removed and a fresh cloth is put on, all those things will have to be done, if at all, try to avoid them. But take care that everybody is fully masked and they are fully covered. And then once the room is empty, it is taken care of as per standard guidelines.
Okay, I think we've got Dr. Gagandi back on. So, Gagandi, anything you want to add? Or
so that's
okay. Back to you, Ambuj.
The next question is, it's quite a practical problem in current weather. The person is asking, you know, how do you sanitize winter clothes? You can't wash them every day when you go back from hospital.
So my question would be, how much do you need to sanitize your clothes if you're wearing your gown properly, and what is the chance of getting infection just because of clothes? So this is something I'm going to ask Dr. Gagandeep and Dr. Aarti Kapil, because this was a fear that was there in the beginning. People would discard their clothes and put them in a separate box and things like that. So Gagandeep, your comments, and then Dr. Aarti.
So as you said, if you're wearing the PPE appropriately, so there should not be any chances of contamination of your clothes underneath. So if at all it gets contaminated, then it can be washed at 70 degrees and then dry. But it's not required daily. I don't think so there would be an incident where the clothes are being contaminated every single day.
Yes, so I think you should, not too much of a concern. Infection through fomites, especially the dresses that you're wearing, getting infected, seems to have become less than what it was in the past. And that is why we keep focusing a lot on wearing a mask properly, having a face shield, rather than the clothes that you're wearing, because the importance of that has become less. Dr. Aarti wanted to say something. Okay. Ambuj?
Yeah. One question asked is, whether the virus can enter through the eyes.
Can the virus enter through the eyes? It's so, Neeraj, your comments on that and what we should do from that point of view.
Definitely all the mucosa which we are talking about, whether it's nasal mucosa, oral mucosa, or even the conjunctiva, and they are thought to be the portal of entry of this virus. So yes, that's the reason why we asked to protect this part, and the reason for using face shield or goggles arise because of that. So currently, yes, we have reason to believe that this virus can actually enter our body through even the eyes. That's why we always ask people to practice hand hygiene, because the tendency to touch eyes, that can in fact help in propagating this virus. So we should be careful about that.
Yes. So I don't know if Gagandeep or Dr. Aarti
just to reiterate, the eyes can be contaminated. It can enter if, like Dr. Neera said, if you touch your hands, touch your eyes with your hands, which are contaminated. So hand wash will prevent. Please, only through when you are doing an aerosol generating procedure and a direct exposure on the eyes, a splash, then that is a problem. Otherwise, please don't think that while walking and while it cannot enter while it is airborne. It will enter if the direct spray droplet falls on your eyes or through your own hands. So while you're walking around in the hospital also, you don't have to worry that it will enter through the eyes.
Yes, I think that's very important, that it's either if there's a direct splash into your eyes or you're rubbing your eyes when your hands are contaminated, that you can get infection through the eyes. It's not that if you're walking in the road, and it can attack your eyes, and therefore you should not only wear your mask, but also start wearing goggles if you're going outside to the market. That is not there. Okay, Ambuj.
Yeah. So again, one more question. It's again a practical question, is what kind of protective wear should one have in the OPDs? You need to wear the gown, or is the mask sufficient? It's been asked by one of the...
So currently what we are doing in the OPD is wearing your mask properly. Some residents would also wear their face shield if they're examining the patient closely. But wearing a gown or wearing a full PPE in terms of the overall is something that we are not doing right now. But I'll ask if Gagandeep has anything to add, or Dr. Aarti want to say anything.
Yes, sir. I totally agree that wearing an N95 mask appropriately is important. And if at all there is some risk while examining the patients, so a face shield should be used. Otherwise, gowns and other components of the PPE are not required in routine OPDs.
Yes, and I'll just add, make sure the room is not overcrowded. You don't have too many patients inside your room. And if possible, there is good cross ventilation, because many of our OPDs are built in a way that there is not good cross ventilation. Try and make sure that there is good cross ventilation. If an exhaust is there, that should be functioning and working well, and avoid a lot of people standing in the room. It's an ideal situation will be to have the OPD outdoor, possibly under a tree or something like that in the sun. But okay.
So another question, I think this has been asked right through the pandemic, is what do you do to disinfect fruits, vegetables, and other stuff that you buy? Do you need to do anything? And if you need to do, what do you need?
So this was something that people are doing very rigorously, using all sorts of things. So Gagandeep and then Aarti, what should we do now?
So they should be just washed properly as we do in routine, and because they're going to be cooked, so there's no danger per se.
Yeah, so even if you peel them properly, then it's also good enough. And washing them properly is all that is required. I mean, don't have to put them in a disinfectant and then take them out and then do that. So, yeah. So a lot of things were being done in the past. Like I said, when this infection started 2 years ago, it was an unknown virus. And there was a lot of things that we didn't know about it. And that's why we did so many preventive steps, which we realized were not of much use. But that has now changed. So we don't really need to bother that much now.
Right, sir. Dr. Ashish Agarwal has asked, I think this has been partly answered, but he just asks, what are the kind of precautions and protection measures to be taken by performing procedures like echo and ultrasound in a patient who is not known COVID status or possibly COVID?
So routine ultrasound or echo when you're close to the patient, what should you do? So Dr. Gagandeep, and then I'll ask Dr. Kapil what they're doing in terms of the ward.
So again, wearing an N95, I think, is the most important. We really don't need to wear any additional PPEs.
Okay, Kapil.
Absolutely. So we are performing echoes and all the procedures with wearing N95, and if there is a chance of aerosolization, we do put an additional face shield over it.
So the same practice needs to be followed. I'd just like to say that even if you don't know the COVID status of the patient, presume he's COVID positive and take these precautions. Don't let your guard down. Presume everyone is positive unless proved otherwise, and therefore any ultrasound or echo or any other procedure that you're doing, please make sure that your N95 is properly worn and it's tightly fitted around you. And if you are still concerned about aerosol, use a face shield also. But that should be good enough.
I agree, sir. I mean, our Ecolab is one of the busiest in the hospital, probably lab. We do more than 250, and we've never asked for any COVID tests for patients for that. And just an N95 does the, except when you're doing a transesophageal, there is a chance of aerosolization, so you could have a face shield at that point of time. Sir, we've kind of saturated all the questions, answered all of them that we have here. So maybe we could summarize.
Okay, so one or two generic questions. I think one other question that people ask is, if they're in, let's say, not in the hospital, but at home, how frequently should they do hand washing? Should it be done at a certain frequency, or it depends on so after they've touched surfaces? So any suggestions on that, Dr. Gagandhi? Frequency of hand washing in a non-COVID area?
The chances, if it's a non-COVID area, so only if you're touching high touch surfaces, then maybe hand hygiene should be done. Otherwise, there's no frequency which is been determined that one needs to do hand hygiene every 20 minutes and then it'll save. So only after touching high touch surfaces, I think hand hygiene can be done.
So if you're touching a lot of surfaces then or before, something that will bring your hands towards your mouth. Mm-hmm. So, before having a meal, or if you're even if you come from outside and you're entering the house, then it's important to follow hand hygiene. But to do it every half an hour, because there was a time when people were doing that like a clockwork, that is of not really required, and that is of no use. Just to highlight that point. I think so one would, if possible, prefer outdoors as compared to indoors. What would you say to that, Dr. Gagandeep, in terms of activities?
So definitely outdoors, weather permitting. Outdoor activities would be preferred, although generally I would say that currently no activities would be much better. But if at all it has to be done, it has to be an outdoor activity with less number of people around.
Yes, so then especially during the day in the north, if it's a sunny day, better to be, you can be outdoors rather than indoors. And like you said, avoid a lot of activities, especially which can lead to crowd formation. One other question which a lot of people ask is that if I have a window AC, it's not a central AC, a window AC, can I use that, or should I also not use a window AC? Because we say central AC should not be used, but what about a single room window AC? Can that be used? It's not relevant at this time of the weather, but in general in the south, still it's warm and people use an AC.
So using, it would really depend upon the situation. If there isn't a COVID positive patient in the house, there's no harm in using the AC. Normally window ACs, they circulate the air that is present in the room, they cool it and it is recirculated. So I've heard of people, where everybody is okay at home, all are COVID negative, still they're not using window AC. So that is not the situation. Easily windows AC can be used if at all, there is no risk of exposure from if one of the members of the family is positive, because it does recirculate.
Yeah, and also keep the vent open so that some degree of air goes out and fresh air comes in. So that is the other thing that can be done. But if no one is positive, then one can still continue to use window ACs. Are there any more questions, Ambuj?
Yes, sir. So there's one question on, anything special for dental OPDs, and maybe like an ENT OPD where you examine closely, or an ophthalmology OPD, is the question. The person has asked, is a mask and a face shield enough, or should they do anything more?
So for dental procedures and for ENT examination, if you're doing a throat examination, is a good N95 mask effective with or without a face shield? Your comments, Dr. Gagandeep Penarthi, what would you say?
So a dental OPD or an ENT OPD, these are very high risk areas, I would say, because there is direct contact with the patient, a lot of aerosols are generated. So here at least we should be wearing, an N95 along with the face shield. And if the risk of exposure to respiratory secretions is there or oral secretions, then even a gown can be worn along with gloves. So high risk areas, and I would definitely say that depending upon the risk, the type of PPE can be one. And again, this area should be, these should be very well ventilated. There should be a good exhaust fan there And a lot of windows and doors should be kept open so that the room is well ventilated.
So I think those are the very important points. One is ventilation. N95, if I would say, you should also wear a face shield and probably gloves also, because you will be touching, probably the dentist will have put his fingers inside the mouth, and so you must have gloves which you should change. And once you've done that procedure, and at the same, so don't use the same gloves for multiple patients, and at the same time, a very good ventilation in the room is essential. Over to you, Ambuj. Yeah.
So this is one question, and again, it's of practical importance, is how long is a patient infective after onset of symptoms? Now that, you know, this don't have a mandatory test at the end of isolation. So he's asking, how long could our patient be infective to others after he's had COVID?
So based on the data, and this is based on previous studies, we don't know it definitely as far as Omicron is concerned, that based on previous studies, it was that after about 7 to 10 days of having in a person who's asymptomatic or no symptoms, and at least 3 days without fever, your chances of infectivity is very low. The initial strata which tried to culture the virus after the 7th day in people who were otherwise asymptomatic and had no fever for 2 to 3 days, found that there was really no virus grown on culture. But this is with the previous strains. Does this apply to Omicron? I'm not sure. But based on that, the guidelines mention that you are most likely non-infectious after the 7th day if you have been having no fever and no other symptoms for at least 3 days. And that is why we've said healthcare workers can come back to work. Now remember, in medicine, there's no black and white. There are always gray areas. So it's never going to be 100%. You may have a few individuals who may still, because of various reasons, it could be your own immune system, whatever be the reason, the viral load, be still infectious for another 2-3 days. And that's why the guidelines clearly say that even when you go back to work, you must wear your N95 properly so that you're able to protect others in case you fall in that small numbers. So it's a pragmatic approach. And I think 7 days is what has been taken as a cutoff. You could argue that if you want to be doubly sure, especially those who are not healthcare workers, it could be even up to 10 days. Neeraj, any comments from your side?
No, sir. I think this is the best way forward considering the number of infection we are getting. And of course, if you are wearing N95 mask after 7 days, then the chances of you spreading an infection is anyway low. And it's an old dictum saying any viral infection usually tend not to last more than 7 days. And this holds true for this particular infection as well. So of course, if you are asymptomatic for last 3 days in terms of if you don't have any fever, then just by wearing a good fitting proper N95 mask will literally cut down any chance of spreading this infection.
Okay, thank you. Ambuj, any more questions?
There's one question by Dr. Ashish. He says that the reports come of RT-PCR because of practical reasons, sometimes come after 5 days of taking the sample. So home isolation should be taken from the sample date or the report date? I guess it is from the sample date.
It is from the sample date or the date symptom. So the sample date or the day you become symptomatic. So you may have become symptomatic 2 days ago, but you gave your sample today. Then day zero becomes 2 days ago.
Right. That's all, sir, for the questions that we have here.
Okay, before I finally conclude, I'd really request if from Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, Mr. Jaiswal, if he has anything to say, and then we can have the final comments before we close for today.
Well, thank you, sir. And I'd like to thank from this ministry each and every participant who is participating in today's webinar. And a special thanks goes to Guleria sir and his team for coordinating and conducting this kind of a knowledge percolation to the deep down to this country. Only request to my participants would be that kindly percolate this knowledge as wide as possible, because then the correct knowledge is the land that can be brought forward. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much. And in conclusion, I'd like just like to say that today we've discussed something very important. It's still evolving, but I think it's very important for us to understand the importance of infection control. Unless we break the chain of transmission, we will continue to have more and more cases. And to break the chain of transmission, both for healthcare workers in the hospital and for the lay public, infection control becomes very, very important. And wearing your mask properly, washing your hands properly are simple things which can go a long way in infection control and breaking the chain of transmission. So I'm going to urge all the doctors who are there today to become champions in promoting infection control practices in the community also. It's not only in the hospital setting, but you must also promote this in the community. Make sure that when you talk to your patients or to other people, that they understand the importance of hand hygiene, wearing a mask, maintaining physical distancing, and how to do these things properly. Because there are a lot of myths which go around in social media, and therefore it has to be done in a proper scientific manner. And I just would request all of you to be part of this process of championing for infection control. It's not only from the point of view of COVID, but for so many infections, both in the hospital and outside. If you talk of emergence of antimicrobial resistance, hand hygiene becomes very, very important. But yet, if you look at most ICUs, hand hygiene is not given the type of importance it should be given. And that leads to infection or hospital-acquired infection happening in a big way. So I would really request all of you to become champions, not only in the hospital, but in the community also. But thank you very much for participating. We have the next session tomorrow. And again, it's very important. This is managing children with COVID. There is a huge concern about children getting the new variant infection more as compared to the past. Is this actually true? What should we do? Because certain hospitals in the US are reporting increasing number of children being admitted in their setup as compared to what they've seen in the past. Also remember, there's a whole argument that children are not vaccinated and therefore are more susceptible. And is there a difference in our treatment strategy when we look at children as compared to adults? What drugs can we give safely? What are the drugs which we cannot give? All of this we'll discuss tomorrow. So I request you all to again log in tomorrow for this important session of managing children with COVID-19. Thank you very much once again for being there today. Have a great day. Thank you.
Thank you.